Next presenter is Dr. Hisako Sakayama. And Dr. Sakayama is going to talk about what became clear in the Diet Fukushima investigation.
First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Caldicott for inviting me to this important symposium. I'm honored to have the opportunity to speak on risk assessment of low-dose radiation in Japan, what became clear in Diet Fukushima investigation. Daily life in Japan can never return to what it was like prior to the Fukushima accident. With more than 900 petabecquerel of radioactive materials released, about 10% of Japan was contaminated, and more than 150,000 people were evacuated from the contaminated area. We must worry about the contamination of vegetables, fish, and even drinking water. Anyone living inside of the sky blue zone in this slide will receive more than 1 millisievert per year, which is the ICRP dose limit for the general population. The lowest level of contamination of the red zone is more than 2 times higher than that of Chernobyl restriction zone. One of the reasons the National Diet Investigation Report concluded that the accident is not over yet is because 676 tons of spent fuel remain in the reactor vessel and the cooling pool of Unit 1 to Unit 4. These vessels are all damaged and continue to release radioactive materials into the environment. Our most pressing concern is Unit 4's cooling pool that's damaged by hydrogen explosion. It has more than 200 tons of spent fuel. If it should collapse from the aftershock, the result would be catastrophic for Japan and the world. In this slide, the red circles indicate earthquakes stronger than magnitude 7. Black circles indicate nuclear power stations. As you can see, Japan is a land of earthquakes with 54 nuclear power reactors and more than 20,000 tons of spent fuel. Until the Fukushima disaster, the majority of the Japanese people did not recognize the danger of this situation. One of the reasons for this is because government and the electric companies thought through the use of not only mass media, but also school education system created a nuclear safety myth. Next, the Ministry of Education, Culture, Sports, Science, and Technology, together with electric power companies, are the main role players. They realized that if the people were afraid of even minute amount of radiation, it would be difficult for them to promote expanding nuclear power policy. Prior to the Fukushima accident, they distributed secondary school textbooks teaching that nuclear power plants were safe. They claimed that the power plants were built on the hard bedrock, they could withstand earthquakes. They also stated plants were designed to bear tsunami and so on. After the accident, however, they had to admit that the plants were not safe, and they recalled the textbook. Nine months after the accident, MEXT distributed a new series of textbooks on the subject of radiation for primary school students as well as junior and senior high school students. Although they claim that purpose of these textbooks is to provide students with the basic knowledge of radiation, they only mention the earthquake and the release of radioactive materials in the introduction. They did not provide any information on the amount of radioactivity released, nor maps of the contaminated areas. In the guidelines for the teachers, they recommended that teachers create an understanding for students that there is no clear evidence that radiation level of lower than 100 millisieverts causes disease. Isn't there any evidence that that shows low level of radiation causes cancer? It is well established that the complex double-strand breaks of DNA induce cancer. Complex double-strand DNA breaks result in error-prone repair, causing mutation and genomic instability, bringing about an accumulation of mutation. The final result is cancer. Even a single track of radiation can result in double-strand breaks and is therefore theoretically capable of inducing cancer. This is because energy of radiation is so much stronger than that of chemical bonds of DNA. For instance, the energy of diagnostic X-ray is 15,000 to 20,000 times greater than that of the chemical bonds. So radiation can easily produce complex double-strand breaks and cause mutations and genomic instability. Experimentally, it has been shown that levels as low as 1.3 millegray can produce double-strand breaks, and the number of the breaks increase linearly with dose. Thus, we have experimental evidence that even a small amount of radiation possible to induce cancer. Then, what is the lowest dose for which good epidemiological evidence shows an increase in carcinogenic risk? One of the most reliable experimental studies is the lifespan study of atomic bomb survivors. In this study, the average radiation dose is 200 millisieverts, with more than 50% having a dose lower than 50 millisieverts. As you can see in this slide, there is no threshold below which no risk was found. A linear non-threshold model provides the best fit to actual cancer data. Besides atomic bomb survivors data, there are many studies showing low-dose radiation risks. There are studies on radiation workers at the nuclear facilities. The people living near the Techa River in Russia, and children that developed leukemia in the vicinity of nuclear power plants and other high background area. In all these studies, the risk per dose of radiation is higher than for the atomic bomb survivors. Radiation also induces non-cancer diseases. The dose-response relationship between non-cancer disease and radiation has been reported for atomic bomb survivors. Dr. Yavrokov and his colleagues have provided us with undeniable evidence demonstrating the relationship between non-cancer disease and radiation. I'm sure Dr. Yavrokov will talk about this matter. Based on experimental and epidemiological studies, the concept that there is no safe dose of radiation has been accepted. The government dose limit of 20 millisievert for Fukushima residents is sacrificing the health of people, especially the health of children. Why do Japanese government and radiation specialists say that their low level of radiation risks are unknown or pose no risk? The Dynasty investigation discovered the reason for the underestimation of the effect of low-dose radiation. A review of TEPCO and Federation of Electric Power Companies, FEPC, records revealed that the highest risk to TEPCO was long-term shutdown of nuclear reactors. TEPCO also realized that natural disasters would cause regulation to be tightened, which would ultimately lead to long-term plant shutdown. They took the easiest path to avoid this risk. They lobbied the Nuclear Safety Committee, NSC, the Nuclear and Industrial Safety Agency, NISA, and MEXT to relax regulation standards, and their efforts were successful. That is, the regulatory authorities became captives of TEPCO and FEPC. The FEPC also successfully lobbied radiation specialists, including ICRP members and NSC, so as to relax radiation protection standards. In one of their documents, they noted that all the lobbying requirements were reflected in ICRP 2007 recommendations. One of the ways FEPC achieved this was covering the travel costs for ICRP members attending international conferences. In spite of this fact, Japanese ICRP members insist that ICRP is neutral and is not represent the interest of the electric industries. FERC is trying to control radiation research for its own benefit. For example, TEPCO's ex-vice president, Mr. Muto, said, "We should monitor the direction of research so that it doesn't go in a bad direction or be led by bad researchers." FERC only wanted research to be carried out that would relax the protection standards. So there is evidence that low-dose radiation has risk. The reason why this risk is proposed to be unknown is because the governmental and electrical companies wish to maintain their nuclear power policy. Next, I would like to talk why stable iodine was not taken by most of the residents. There are two ways the local mayors can receive advice as to when they should advise residents to take stable iodine. One, directly from NSC. Two, from the government of Fukushima Prefecture. After the accident, the NSC had sent a fax to the local nuclear emergency response headquarters recommending that residents take iodine. For some reason, the fax did not reach the mayors. It disappeared. And to this day, nobody knows where it went. The NSC also sent a fax to Fukushima government. However, nobody noticed the fax till 18th, which was too late as all the residents had already evacuated. Though the government of Fukushima did not receive any advice from NSC, he should have independently advised the residents to take iodine. He did not, as he had been waiting for advice from NSC. There were some mayors who independently decided to advise people to take iodine. Unfortunately, most of the mayors hesitated and did not. In all, only 10,000 residents ended up taking iodine. The reasons the mayor hesitated to give advice to take iodine were, one, mayors were afraid of the side effect of iodine, since NSC had emphasized the side effect. Two, the NSC's guideline recommended that stable iodine should be taken in the presence of medical expert. In most cases, there were no medical experts around. Three, they did not understand why iodine should be taken, nor were they informed as to the appropriate time for it to be taken. Next, problem with radiation emergency medicine network. Radiation emergency medicine is the medical treatment provided in the event of radiation exposure. In Japan, Radiation Emergency Medicine Network has three layers. Primary hospital provides the initial medical treatment for all victims. When a primary hospital is unable to treat a patient due to the exposure level being too high, the patient is transferred to a secondary emergency hospital. If the secondary hospital cannot handle the victim, whatever the reason, they are transferred to tertiary hospitals. Japan has just two tertiary hospitals, one for Eastern and one for Western Japan. Unfortunately, the network was set up without considering the possibility of large-scale spread of radioactive materials. Because of this, many of the hospitals were located close to the power plant. At the time of accident, there were six primary radiation emergency medical hospitals in Fukushima, of which three were located within a 10-kilometer radius of the power plant. The three hospitals thus became unusable as the staff and patient had to evacuate. There were four other regular hospitals within 20-kilometer zone. The staff and patient from them also had to evacuate. During the course of evacuation, 60 patients died. Diet investigation team surveyed the location of radiation emergency hospitals. More than 50% of the 59 primary hospitals nationwide are located within 20-kilometer radius of nuclear power plants. That means they are within evacuation zone and would become unusable in the event of serious accident. We also found that the maximum number of patients that can be hospitalized by each of the primary and secondary hospitals is just one or two. How about the two tertiary emergency hospitals? They can handle no more than 10 critically ill patients. The radiation emergency medical network did not function during the disaster. Unfortunately, the situation has not improved since the accident. Considering current medical condition in Japan, it will be difficult to improve the situation in the short term. Therefore, Japan is not ready to operate nuclear reactors. Now, I'd like to talk about Fukushima Health Management Survey. Not long after the disaster, Fukushima Prefecture launched the Fukushima Health Management Survey to investigate the long-term low-dose radiation on health. It has two parts, a basic survey and detailed survey. The detailed survey involves the ultrasound examination for Fukushima children up to 18 years old. Some preliminary data from the thyroid ultrasound examination was made public. In 2011, approximately 38,000 children were examined. 95,000 were examined in 2012. In 2011 survey found 186 children with nodules larger than 5 millimeters or cysts larger than 20 millimeters. Within 186 children, three were diagnosed with thyroid cancer and seven have susceptible thyroid cancer. As for 2012 examinee, detailed announcement has yet to be made, though one thyroid cancer had been diagnosed. An investigation of 4,500 children from control group outside of Fukushima is now ongoing. Although the thyroid cancer incidence seems to start increasing in the Fukushima children, we need to wait for the detailed result, the control study. In conclusion, I would like to say that I think the endless debate on low-dose radiation risk is not a scientific matter, but a political, economical, and social problem. I hope scientists will speak the scientific truth not for government or electric companies, but for the people. Four nuclear reactors have been damaged, and nobody knows how or when they will be isolated from the environment. As Japan is sitting on earthquake belt, we are in race with time to make nuclear plants safe. The Japanese government and electric companies must make it their priority to do the best to stop any further damage and halt the ongoing leakage of radioactive substances. It is their responsibility since they promoted Japan's nuclear power policy. It is also responsible of every person in Japan to make sure that all plants that are currently running are shut down. We must also ensure that no further nuclear plants are restarted. I would like to ask you to work together with us for this purpose. Thank you for your attention.